Okay, my name is Ellen Carlson Solander, and I was born in New York City on the 4th of September, 1923.
What are some principles by which you live?
Well, the first and most important one is that left is right, which means I'm left-handed. And people who are left-handed are discriminated against even today.
I'm left-handed as
well. Okay. So I basically believe and have always believed that all people should be respected, regardless of almost anything. And that if you want to categorize it, you could say it was every human being has a spark of the divine.
What have you found that really matters about life?
That really matters
about life?
Well, unfortunately, very fortunately, I was married for 60 years and my husband died. And the most important thing was, he was my most important thing, I realize. And the nicest thing of all is that I cannot remember any real disagreements. I know we had them, but I can't remember what they were.
What are some of the most difficult things you've ever done?
Most difficult things I've ever done? Well, there were, when I was in the 50s, I worked for an organization called the Southern Conference for Human Welfare, which was trying to integrate the South. So I went to various Southern cities and interviewed people. That was very frightening. But the big thing I knew was that I had a plane ticket in my pocket and could leave, and they couldn't. The other difficult thing was going to law school.
Reflect on your proudest accomplishments, and if you wish, your most bitter disappointments.
Well, I can't tell you what my proudest accomplishment is or was, even though I became a full professor at SMU at a time when there were only 12 women full professors. I didn't think that was an accomplishment. I thought that SMU was wrong. And I don't know what my bitterest disappointment is, other than that they were unable to cure my husband.
What do you consider as a significant turning point in your life?
A significant, when I decide, whenever I think about this, I think about how naive I was. I was a housewife in the 50s and a volunteer, and I went and interviewed the people at the juvenile department, and I realized that they lied to me. So I thought to myself, I don't like being treated like a dumb North Dallas lady, so I will get credentials. And that's when I went to law school. And of course, I know now, as a lawyer, that if I go and interview somebody at the juvenile department, they'll go right ahead and lie to me.
Who or what have you been most inspired by?
Thomas Jefferson.
What some reasons why?
Because Thomas Jefferson was a believer in that all men are created equal. And if he thought about it, he would have unfortunately have had to say all men and women, but he didn't. But I think one of the unfortunate things is that we lost the Equal Rights Amendment.
What have you learned from your success and mistakes?
From my success and mistakes?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what my successes were. All I know is that a lot of my students seem to appreciate me still, even though I've been retired for quite a while. And I didn't realize it, but I taught family law long before gays were even mentioned. And yet, at the same time, I realized that I was ahead of my time because I don't approve of the way marriage is structured, even now, because there's really no reason that the church should get into marriage. There really is no reason that the government should get into marriage. In fact, it should just be, I realize it needs to be written down because as a lawyer, I know that, but it should not be something that people meddle with.
Which age have you enjoyed the most and why?
Well, I would guess my 70s when we were married and we traveled all over the place and had energy. The difference between 70 and 87 is the amount of energy you have. And that's the, unfortunately, as you get older, you have less energy.
Where do you find a real sense of community?
Real sense of community. As a member of the League of Women Voters, it's one of those wonderful organizations that unfortunately has aged. Its members have aged because of the fact that too many people work outside the home as well as have the home, which was me too. So I dropped out pretty much.
Okay. What do you hope to see in the future?
It would be nice if we had a single-payer medical system. It would be nice if everybody was respected. It would be nice if we could stop having people buy drugs and spend money on things that cause and buy guns and give them to the Mexicans. And well, obviously they don't give them. Everything is in the drug industry is bad. And it's all our fault. It's really not the Mexicans' fault. And I don't know what to do about it.
Did you have a mentor, male or female, and what have you learned from him or her?
No.
No, you don't have a mentor. Okay.
Unless you count my husband.
Sure.
Who was supportive of everything. You know, having a law professor as a wife is inconvenient. So he was very supportive.
Okay, just one more question. Is there anything else you would want to impart on viewers? Let's see this.
Well, I just have to describe my experience when I went to law school.
Okay.
I went to law school at age 44. And this was in 1967. And at that time, if you were over 30, you were over the hill. So I never mentioned my age to my classmates. So I have to assume that, you know, they accepted me. Maybe they thought I was 32 when I was actually 45 or whatever. But the most amazing experience was one that my son told me. We went to a restaurant and it's a restaurant where almost always somebody comes up to me and says, "Hello, Professor Follander, I was a student of yours." And this night, nobody came up. So when he was waiting for the car, he overheard two men speaking to each other. And one said to the other, this was like 3 weeks ago, and one said to the other, "Did you see Professor Solander?" Yes, but they had not said anything to me. And they said, "You know, she's been retired. I guess she must be about 70. So that's what I like. Young people think that everybody that's old is 70.
Now, how long did you teach for?
20 years.
20 years. And what was the best part about that?
Well, I got to teach First Amendment and the mass media. And that's a very interesting subject, as you can imagine. And of course, if I had continued teaching First Amendment and the mass media, it would have encompassed a lot more than newspapers and libraries and making speeches because of the internet. So it would have been really interesting.
Now, how do you see the internet impacts our culture?
How do I what?
See how it impacts the culture and mass media.
Well, unfortunately, all you have to do is look at the lies about the healthcare reform, and you can see what impact that has on our culture. The fact that I'm amazed that my congressperson, who is a Republican, has, according to the Dallas News, more people without health insurance than anybody else. And that he shouldn't be voting against health care.
Is there anything else you want to say, or?
Yes.
Okay.
When John Paul Stevens retires, we need to appoint a woman to the Supreme Court, because this business of just having two women on the Supreme Court is absurd. We actually need four to begin with, maybe five. But anyway, three would be better than two.